Hello and welcome back to Let's Play Alundra. On the previous episode, we picked up the Charm Boots, the final footwear upgrade in the game, which allows us to walk on the lava floors as if they were normal. Kind of like the sand boots did for us sand floors, except they also prevent the damage from walking. Now, between that and the fact that we picked up Navis Charm a little while ago, which allows us to avoid all damage we might take from fire-based enemies and the spigots, the rest of this dungeon will be pretty easy, and basically every challenge will be reduced to more or less an annoyance, like these firebird enemies here that are surprisingly difficult to hit between the fact that they're aerial enemies, which means they aren't hit by ground-based attacks, and the fact that the ice wand has a really weird trajectory, which makes it kind of difficult to be accurate. Still, you want to take the time to kill these enemies now, because you get hit with their attacks while you're carrying the rock. Even if you don't take any damage, you'll still drop the rock and it'll shatter, forcing you to zone in and out and fight them all again anyway, so you might as well take care of them now. The easiest way to do it is to attack vertically like I did just there, because it factors out the weird arc of the ice wand and makes things a little bit easier for yourself. So once you do that, you can bring the rock over here and pick up the second rock, which you can now use as a step stool, using both rocks in tandem, to get up to this key door in the north part of the room. Now, we did pick up a key, in case you happen to remember, from that episode I aired, 11 months ago, and we can enter this larger cavern here. And if you go up here and talk to the statue, it should be pretty clear. The hint's a little out there, but it's not too difficult to figure out what you're supposed to do, at least at first glance. There are 7 torches scattered around the room, and the end goal is to have all 7 torches lit while standing on a moon symbol in the center of this little complex. Now, with every torch you light, one of the doors in the room will close, which means it's entirely possible that you can light all 7 torches while locking yourself out of the room containing the moon symbol. So you have to be kind of careful in terms of the order in which you light all the torches, and I believe this is a very specific order you have to do it in. You basically only want to light the torches that correspond to the door you just came through, so you're only moving, so you can only move forward, and you never wind up locked out of the way you want to go. The biggest difficulty I personally found with this room is that it isn't always entirely clear which way you want to go, or which way it's possible to go, because the rooms are divided up by these rocks, and especially when you're moving left to right, you can't really see whether or not there's a hole you can go through. So like right over here, you can walk through to the left, but you can't do it while you're up on the cliff, which I guess could lead some players to get stuck for a little while and sort of lead you to believe that you made the wrong decision when you really didn't. Now there's one more torch we have to light. We have to kind of circle the room 3 times, and we finished one already, making our first pass. We can't go over here at all, although you'd think that you would be able to. Again, it kind of looks like you should be able to. So we want to make one more pass back into the center to light one more torch, and then we can go back around and find the moon symbol room. So if we go down here to the south, that's the moon symbol I was referring to. We want to go south from here, hit this torch, and then go back around one more time, again, following the rule that we always want to light a torch that corresponds to locking the door that we just came through. And once we finish this, all you have to do is step on the moon symbol, and all the doors will actually unlock again. Just from looking at the way the room is arranged, I would naively suspect it's actually possible to get yourself stuck in here, but I'm not really sure. I mean, it would kind of suck if after all this trouble you went through... I mean, we aren't too far from the last save room, but it would be pretty annoying if you had to reset, because you locked yourself in the door. Anyway, now that we're here, all the doors unlock, and we can proceed to the next room. And, we can ignore the turtles. You don't get anything for killing all the enemies in this room. It's not a kill room whatsoever. So we'll move here to the north, and there's gonna be some more of the firebirds in this room, and some pillars, but we don't have to deal with that right now. What we actually want to do first is jump in the hole. This will actually happen a lot in the next few levels. For some reason, almost every time you see a hole in this game, you're going to want to jump down it immediately. So again, let's get these guys out of the way. You can see the magic seed platforms all over this room, so again, it's definitely in our best interest to kill these birds now, so we don't have to worry about it later. And let's go ahead and spread our seed all around this room. Again, just to be an absolute pain in the butt, you actually have to jump just to get the seed to land in these platforms in the first place. This should be really familiar. We've had to do something very similar to this in a previous side quest dungeon, so if you haven't gone through that cave previously, I don't know why this platform is here at all. You can't actually use it to get up on the spring plants. Anyway, if you've been through that cave once already, this shouldn't present any challenge to you whatsoever. But is it worth it? I mean, why are we doing this? Let's get to the end. I hate diagonal jumps in this game. Yeah, there we go. Alright, up in this platform we get, and yes, indeed it is worth it. That's the 47th Gilded Falcon, so we only have 3 left before we can claim whatever the final reward is. And believe me when I tell you, it is definitely worth it. I actually finished recording all the remaining episodes of the series today, and I finally got my hands on the reward for the first time in my life, and it was pretty cool getting to use it. Anyway, the first thing you want to do here is to burn away these brambles with the fire wands. I actually really like that for a fire dungeon, there's use for both the fire and the ice wands intermittently. I think the symmetry between the two items is cool, and I'm glad that those are the two primary items you get to use in completing most of the puzzles here. So obviously it's pretty easy to figure out how to get this sliding ice block up there, thankfully. We haven't had to do too many difficult ice puzzles just yet. So these spigots, I have shown in the previous episode that you can turn them off by jumping on them. There's something odd about these exact spigots that show up in this dungeon. I've run into them later in other dungeons, and they don't work like this. You can't turn them off just by jumping on them. So apparently they have multiple sprites with different rules, which I guess is kind of cool, but it will throw you a little bit if you get close to them, thinking you can turn them off, and you find out you can't, and they're actually just obstacles that are supposed to be avoided. I'm not sure if that's good game design or not. Like, I'm not a game designer. It just bugged me a little bit when I got hit in the face with a fire, with a, you know, a fire spout from something I thought was turned off. Anyway, I talked to this guy, and he speaks pretty clearly. There's two puzzles, one to the left, one to the right, and both of them need to be solved. The left one, I think, is the easier one. You've only got one sliding pillar to use, so once you've only got, you know, when there's only one moving part in a puzzle, there's only so much you can do with it. So it's not too difficult to figure out what that one thing is supposed to be. All we're going to do is we're going to move this little pillar from one corner of the room to the other, and use it to access each of these torches. And the only real challenge is making sure that you don't accidentally slide it back towards one of the side walls while you're trying to jump. The controls in this thing are actually pretty slippery. You can see while I was being really tentative jumping up to that torch up there, that I didn't want to push it north and wind up getting it stuck somewhere I couldn't get it back out again. The second room is a little bit more difficult, again, because there's two moving parts, two of these. I don't know why they made you bother hitting them with ice. They serve absolutely no purpose in their fire form. These bottom two are pretty easy. As long as you're aware of, you know, Alundra's jumping limitations, you can get up to these left and right platforms pretty easily just by using the south sliding pillar. Now we can reach this upper right one again pretty easily using the other pillar, and we do need both pillars to get to the upper left. I guess this is the one really tricky part to this puzzle. But again, I'm showing you the solution, so I guess if you're watching this Let's Play, nothing ever really looks as tricky as it actually is. So we finished that. You can hit those barrels if you really want some pickups, but again, if you've been following this walkthrough, you should have Navis Charm and the Charm Boots by now, and you should basically be taking zero damage as you run throughout this dungeon. I mean, at this point, it doesn't really matter. I'm just closing these spigots because it's annoying to get hit by them, and I prefer not to. You know, you never know why I might forget something and have to go back. Anyway, this chest here contains our major reward for getting through this dungeon, the Fire Book. The Fire Book is useless here because every enemy in here is fire elemental and is invulnerable to the magic. But in general, the fire magic is actually probably the most useful magic in the entire game. We're going to be using it for basically every boss fight from here on out, except this one. Jesus Christ, that is one huge fire dragon. Now, if you watch the opening cutscene to the game, you probably had a... I mean, it actually spoils a bit that there's going to be a fire dragon fight later in the game. And it actually tips you off as to what you're supposed to do, although it really shouldn't be surprising, because we've been using this item the entire game. Or I should say this entire level. Wilda, the fire dragon, is only weak to the ice wand. She's not weak to magic, and she's not weak in her body. She's only weak on her face. Now, you may notice that, just like everything else in this dungeon, equipping Navis Charm makes us take no damage from her fire attacks, and she only has, like, two fire attacks, and no basic attacks. You can take damage from walking into her face, which I do in a little bit, but again, even that does fire damage, you know, because she's a fire dragon. So, at this point, it's actually impossible to take any damage whatsoever from this fight. And unfortunately, the fight continues to take forever, because Wilda's immune to magic, which means our usual technique for killing bosses really quickly is not valid for this entire fight. So all we're really going to do is sit here and use the charge shot as much as we can. Wilda has something like 100 HP. The charged hits take off, I think, 2, and the regular shots take off 1. This... I want to say this was an attack. I heard somewhere it was possible to get hit and stunned by the rocks that fall when Wilda does the roar, but I don't think it actually does anything. I've never actually... I mean, I would suspect, since I'm equipped with Navis Charm, it would be the only attack she had that's capable of doing any damage to me, but apparently it isn't. So yeah, that's, I guess, her one other attack. She can spray out some fireballs that go all the way to the back, but in case, as you'll watch over the course of this, you know, six-ish minute fight, it gets easier and easier to dodge. I mean, these are very slow-moving fireballs, and they pretty much always land in about the same spots. So once you get used to the pattern, even if you don't have Navis Charm, you really shouldn't take that much damage from this fight, and especially if you've been abusing the casino games, it really isn't that big of a deal to use items to replenish your health if you happen to need it. I mean, if you go back to Lurby's shop, the most expensive item in the game is the Wonder Essence, which only costs 200 Gilder. What's Gela? I think that's Wild Arms. Sorry, wrong game. Anyway, yeah. Once you've gotten accustomed to the patterns of Wilda's attacks, you can even sort of very easily walk between the projectiles before they land to make sure that you don't get pinned behind them for the rare opportunities you get to actually attack Wilda's head. And God forbid this fight takes long enough that you don't really want to do that. I'd actually read a little bit before I started this final sequence of recordings that one of the things Working Designs did when they took over this game, or took over publication of this game, was they retuned several of the boss fights. And if you're familiar with some of their other works, like the Lunar remakes or the Arclad remakes, you'd know that generally speaking, when they localize a game for America, they tend to make a lot of changes to the flow of the gameplay to be balanced, to flow better. I remember in Lunar, if you read their the guide they put out, they removed several boss fights from the game entirely because they thought they were inappropriate and broke the flow of the storyline or the flow of the gameplay overall. So, although the remakes, or I should say the adjustments that were done to Alundra were not quite so severe, I don't think they cut anything out. They did definitely rebalance a lot of the boss fights. I believe to prevent situations exactly like this, there were a lot of bosses in the game that couldn't really do a lot of damage to you, but took a ridiculous amount of hits. So basically the entire boss fight boiled down to you trying not to take, 50 hits before you were able to knock down the boss's massive life bar. So I guess I'm not really sure why this fight is still in here. I mean, I know I complained about a few of the fights early on in the game, like the Soul Leech, where it feels like you're fighting these enemies forever. But this one, I mean, it takes like 60 hits on the Ice Wand to kill Wilda, and as I've shown just now, it's entirely possible to be in a position where she is literally incapable of damaging you at all. So it's ridiculous to me that this takes as long as it does. I mean, if this happened in a modern game, I think these days a lot of indie developers would have some kind of, like, if this happened in like EG or something like that, like any of those games that have been published recently with a lot of retro appeal, it seems quite likely that the developers would know that you had a particular loadout of items that makes it impossible for the boss to kill you, and the boss might actually like commit suicide or something funny like that. But I guess we don't get that for the Wilda fight. I mean, we're pretty close to the end. I think I've only got about a minute left at this point. So yeah, I guess I don't really have anything much to report other than the fact that I can tell you, while I have a little bit of time, before the next, useful thing to comment on, or the next change in gameplay, is that at the time I'm recording this, I actually have completed the video for every remaining episode. All I have to do is record commentary over them. So I can guarantee that unlike the previous attempt to come off of hiatus, this one will stick. I have nothing left to do but provide commentary. Every remaining episode is prepared. So this LP will be seen through to completion on my usual, or I should say what used to be my usual 3 uploads a day schedule within about 2 weeks. So I hope the rest of you are looking forward to that, because I'm certainly happy to be back. And that was the right time to deliver that little advertisement, because we finally killed Wilda. We've put Wilda on ice. That's awesome. This is actually exactly what happens in the opening cutscene, if you happen to have seen it. Alundra will fire his ice wand and will literally free, you'll see an anime cutscene where you freeze Wilda. Which I think is pretty cool, because it gives you a nice hint as to how you're supposed to go about this fight without having to worry too much about it. Because if you don't have Navis Charm, this fight is pretty difficult. Those jellied fireballs do a lot of damage. But instead, I mean, I guess being frozen solid doesn't preclude Wilda from talking. Or from giving us the Emerald Quest. Crest. Alright, so Wilda will use the last of his or her power to get us back, and then he will explode. And then also his head explodes for some reason. I don't know, whatever. Anyway, so now we've obtained the 6th crest, which means we've only got one more crest to go. But you may notice that since we're missing 3 life vessels and 3 gilded falcons, that there are probably 3 dungeons left in the game, and you would be correct. In fact, by reading that dialogue just there, it clues you in pretty easily that this next area in the game is going to be a nightmare dungeon, the final nightmare dungeon in this game. So wait a minute for our cue. Where's Maya? Any minute now. There we go. Maya's about to wake us up for the final Lightmare Dungeon in the game. Yep. So remember the Murg? No, I'm not awake. Yes. Yes, I'm awake. Fine. Yes. Burgess, the twin, has been kidnapped by the Murg. Are we going to get him back? I guess so. We'll see. I guess I'll see you on the next episode of Let's Play Alundra, and we'll rescue the twin. See you then.